to fight him. And when they pulled down from the floor, Leroy looked like a jigsaw puzzle with a couple of pieces gone.
Welcome to the 2-month review of the weekly podcast brought to you by Open Letter and 3%, in which we take one giant difficult book, break it down bit by bit, section by section, talk about it, analyze it, have fun. This season we are reading Mulligan Stew by Gilbert Sorrentino, going up to page 327 today. And I am Chad Post from Open Letter Books, joined as always by Brian Wood, author of Joytime Killbox.
Yes, but I might change the title of it. I don't know yet. Can you do that after a book is published?
Change you can title? Definitely do that. You can do that anytime you want.
All right, I might change it. Who knows? We'll see.
I've been trying to come up with multiple jokes about baseball this morning. I was going to flub that intro and have you say, like, attaboy, Chad, attaboy. And then I would glare at you and fucking crush all night long. or I could just scream D-backs over and over because they are the greatest team on earth. They have so much flow. I love that team.
Well, help me. I'm ignorant to most baseball stuff. Who said attaboy at somebody?
Orlando Arcia said it to about Bryce Harper after Bryce Harper got doubled off to end game two. And then Bryce Harper went yard twice last week or twice last night. And as he rounded the bases.
Four ribbies for Bryce Harper.
And he just glared at Orlando Arcia, just glared. It was amazing. He's like, fuck you guys. So. Yeah, for anyone who's a Phillies fan, you'll know that reference. And the D-backs knocked out the Dodgers. Everyone loves that. Everyone hates the Dodgers.
Apparently. I looked at the box score. That seemed like a really strange way to win a game. Four solo home runs.
It was like solo home run, out, solo home run, out, solo home run. It was like the weirdest inning to watch.
Really strange. Yeah, strange way to win. Dodgers. I mean, they're such a good team, you know. They keep getting there. They're dominating their division and just can't get over the hump.
Fair enough. I am a regular season proponent for like who the best team is. And like they and Atlanta were by far the best teams in the National League. But the playoffs is just like a tournament. And like it matters obviously because it's crowns the World Series, it's fun, and it's like makes everything like a microcosm. Every event becomes super high leverage, everything's like uber scrutinized, but it's like more a tournament than it is. Like you wouldn't always say like the team that wins the NCAA tournament was the best basketball team that season. There's
it's hot
so
at the right
flukiness. Yeah, there's so much flukiness.
I have a question to pivot this back to Mulligan Stew. Do you prefer watching good baseball or bad baseball?
I hate going to the Red Wings games. When they're the local AAA affiliate they're bad, because I find it like really tough to swallow watching like something that's just like an easy play and then they just muff it up. So not so much with the bad. I prefer the good, but I do like people making mistakes.
I'm not saying bad baseball like they're not good players. I'm talking about like sloppy ugly games versus like really good high level. I mean, I assume you appreciate both, but
seeing someone like mess up like in a grand fashion is always entertaining. Sort of like the Rick Ankiel yips moment. Like Rick Ankiel like killed me and like changed my fandom forever. But like watching him throw like 17 consecutive wild pitches was like.
but the humanness of it. But I bring that to like as an editor and somebody that acquires books, I assume you read a lot of bad books and a lot of bad manuscripts. Well, I don't want to, I shouldn't assume, but it's like, I heard one person say like, you know, you go to the Met and you look at the artwork and like every single piece that's there is eternal and wonderful and beautiful. But you have to keep in mind that for every piece of artwork that's hanging on the wall, there's 20,000 pieces that are trash that are not
200,000, 2 million.
Yeah. Just throw any number you out there, but like, we forget to realize that for everything that you see that is good and worthwhile, there is a giant pile of trash, as this book says, of pure shit that that did not make. Do you enjoy reading the bad writing or no?
No.
Okay.
I don't. I enjoy this. This is like a shit palace. Like it's like taking the shit and building something intricate and beautiful. But no, most things are just really bad. And okay. And you can usually tell within like a couple paragraphs, you're like, this isn't gonna be any fun.
Yeah. Because I mean, there's a, you know, going back to Mulligan, so we're reading a very bad book. Within the book, we're reading a very bad book, but the way it's put together is a good book. So it's kind of like this weird, I don't know, it's like a literary burrito of something. Right.
Sorrentino is King Midas and like takes all that shit and turns it to gold. Sure.
Yeah.
I don't know. That's like a bad metaphor, but this book is, this section is filled with bad metaphors and aphorisms.
Oh, it's lovely. It's like, it's one of those like so bad, like there's movies like that, right? Like so bad. They're so bad that it's good. And you watch them to mock them and to laugh at them. And in some ways it's very mean and there's something mean spirited about it. But at the same time, it's like the joy of like, at the end of it, it's like, you know what? Like, hats off to you for putting it out there. Like,
yeah.
you know, like the first one that comes to mind is obviously Tommy Wiseau, The Room. But like, sometimes you wonder about the mental state of the person creating it, that do you actually believe this is good? Do you actually believe you're doing, like, do you think you're doing Streetcar Named Desire with this movie, The Room? You know?
I'm thinking of like Fast X. Fast X is not as bad as The Room, obviously, but in some ways it is. But it's also like, I don't know what their budget was, but it's like $500 million to make this movie. And like, they're just like, wait, what? But they're like, what? Like, for $500 million, you can make fun of anything. Like, anyone that the amount of money that's made, everything, like, it is fair game. But also, like, I think with the bad books are harder because they're usually done in isolation to some degree. Whereas like with movies or music, that has a lot of collaborators who are simultaneously being like, yeah, let's green light this. It's perfect. It's like every commercial I ever see, I'm like, who the fuck said yes to this? Who the fuck in their right mind watched this commercial and was like, that's what I want. That's what we should do. Let's put it out there.
Yep. That's the way to sell herpes medication.
Yep.
So I guess just like real quick before we get into what this session is about, like, did you find yourself at all start to kind of like lean in to Tony a little bit more in this, like, because he's hitting him with the ugly stick, right? He's worse and worse and worse, and we'll learn from the letters on this section that he's really bad, really bad, really bad. But there's something about him where it's like he's starting to realize he's not good,
and yeah,
that realization of that crumbling castle that is his life, like, I found myself start to sympathize with him a lot more than I thought I would with how terrible of a person he is and how ugly.
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, Sorrentino does a great job of writing complicated, horrific men in a lot of books, and they're really exposing their shortcomings, especially in terms of like ego and self-belief or whatever.
We see him losing his sister, he's losing his editor, he's losing his book, he's losing the lady that he wanted to rape. Like, he absolutely is just like, every drink is poured in his face, everything is trash, everything is burning. It's like, and he deserves all of that.
Yeah.
He really deserves all of that. But at the same time, it's just like, oh man, even your characters hate you. Like, dude, you suck. You suck so bad.
I mean, there's like the cracks to his psyche start really early on when you read this. Bits, like the little pinpricks that are going in. But this is where, like I alluded to last week, where once the title changes, so in this section, well, first to recap for anyone who hasn't been listening or needs a refresher, Anthony Lamont is writing a book that was called Red Guinea. It is now called Crocodile Tears, which is the thing that
is we need. Guinea Red or Red Guinea?
Guinea Red, sorry, Guinea Red. And now Crocodile Tears. And within that book, which is bad, there is a murder. Halpin kills Ned Beaumont. Maybe he doesn't remember. We're not sure why exactly. And then Ned Beaumont was having an affair with Daisy and got involved with two like lusty, I'm going to say lusty broads. I'm not sure what else to call them, like semi-con artists of a lascivious sort. They loses all their money. And then that novel, which is bad, the characters of Halpin and Beaumont are both like escaping, going to a nearby town. they hate being part of the characters of this book. Meanwhile, there's a professor that was going to teach one of Lamont's earlier books and decides not to, and they've been in correspondence. He's also corresponding with his sister, who has just married his arch nemesis, who might not even be aware that he's his arch nemesis, but that's okay. And then there's Lorna Flambeau, who sent him some poems, and he wanted to bone her because they were sex poems, but she's not interested. And then there's the old love of his life that he keeps sending messages to about how he just wants like to connect. And then that's probably all you need to know so far. All the characters that are moving around can meet other characters who are stuck in other books or have experienced other books and worked in other books, as if they are like the characters are laborers.
Yeah, and the characters are trying to formulate an escape plan. You know, it's like,
yeah, exactly. And so when you
mentioned like, this cabin and get out of here, yeah,
they're stuck in this weird cabin that keeps changing and shifting. They have no idea why, or someone else is like writing onto this cabin or adding floors and rooms or materials. There's no sense to this cabin anymore, where they're waiting for the police, but also they've not called the police because there's no phone, and Anthony Lamont never wrote in them actually calling the police or helping calling the police. So that's not really happening. When it changes to Crocodile Tears is when there's a real change in Lamont's attitude. Like up till now, he has been like, he's always being shit on. He's always the worst as like a human being and like a writer. And within every relationship, he's like dismissed and made fun of in various ways and like sabotage. But now, instead of just taking it and being like, well, you know, here's this, maybe I could do this for you. Or like, this is good. I thank you, Sheila, for like, I want you to look at my great piece and blah, blah, blah. Now he's like fucking pissed. And now he's like that. What's that movie with Michael Douglas that he gets out of the car and just goes on a rampage when they're stuck in traffic?
Falling Down.
Yeah. He's starting to edge towards that sort of like psycho male behavior.
He's gonna shoot up a McDonald's with a Mac-10 because they're not gonna give him an egg McMuffin.
I mean, there is a way that you could read this as like the parable of that sort of like what are those people called? Incels.
Yeah.
Like you can sort of read it that way and see it. It's not entirely like a one-to-one, but there is like a real fraying on the edges. And like his like
he masquerades as like this alpha male writer, right? Like this literary like that's his psyche. That's what he thinks he is. And then as he's starting to realize, you're not that and you're not good. And we're not gonna publish it. I'm not gonna teach it. And I'm not gonna read it anymore. Stop writing me these letters, and I'm not gonna have sex with you. Like all of these things, like he's being confronted with all of that reality.
Yep. It's really amazing. And it all hinges on this title change, which I meant to look up. Like Crocodile Tears are like the fake
tear. Insincere, like an insincere apology. Yeah.
Is there any other history to that phrase that would be pertinent?
I don't know the etymology of it, but I think it's like the idea of like a crocodile doesn't cry. And okay. So, right, like it's this predator that's going to absolutely destroy you, and it's faking it just to get you to have sympathy for it when there should be no sympathy for the crocodile, which is interesting because it's like I was saying, like I'm starting to feel sympathy for this character, and he just changed the title to Crocodile Tears.
So here is the it stems from the belief, I don't guess not true if it's saying belief that crocodiles shed tears when attacking and eating their victims.
Okay.
So
there you go.
That sort of like is the marker of like he's gonna go crazy in this. So I mean, I wrote down like there's a few different like major kind of like bits to this, and that him starting with him like that, his paranoia reaches a peak here, like real peak. So like
maybe we should, like, if you don't mind, quickly discuss the Red Swan.
Oh, okay.
Because yeah. Would you think that that's the catalyst of the title change of his book, and then the title change of the character as far as losing grip on reality is this encounter with Red Swan?
Right. And Red Swan itself went through a title change, which I think prompts like his title change. So Red Swan is, and this is where like his paranoia has reached its the highest point, its acme, its whatever. And it he's like writing to Sheila and he's like, did Dermont like fuck with my shit and write to this professor and get him to kick my book out? Because now this professor is talking about Dermont's old book that's being reissued and like wants to teach that. And we know that's trash. We agreed it's trash. He says it's trash. It's trash. It's just bad porn trash. And now this guy is teaching it. And then she sends him a galley that has an introduction by Vance Whitestone. And Vance Whitestone was an editor that rejected Three Deuces by Lamont. So he's like particularly pissed. And then Whitestone's introduction makes Red Swan, this like short 100-page book that's like very porny and apparently was like an erotic bestseller under a different name, and then becomes Red Swan, is now like a literary masterpiece. It sounds fucking terrible. It sounds as bad as anything Lamont's written, which I think is kind of also like intentional like play, where like the things that become popular and get rediscovered aren't necessarily being rediscovered or popular because they're good. It's just luck. It's just like coincidence. It's just like the working of the system. Like there's like now Vance Whitestone has said, this book is great. The professor is saying this book is great. That book will be deemed great. And I think that that is a bit of Sorrentino's real look at the fiction world. There's that letter that I referenced last week, which I've read in full, and along with a couple of follow-up ones, in which he talks about like his own books, like Imaginative Qualities of Actual Things being like underappreciated, but then 15 years, it will come back. And then he like rails against all the writers who are part of like the academic MFA scene in the 1970s and early 80s, who have like these sinecures where they're like teaching and writing, and everyone they sort of log roll each other by like making sure that they, you know, get invited to each other's campus, and they like praise each other and they create like their own movement. And Sorrentino's not part of that. Like he's until like the mid to late 80s, he's not in academia at all until he goes to Stanford.
Rather than that, Ned said one would be better off working in feature roles in first novels by students in creative writing workshops. Quote, the bottom of the barrel. So I realize that's not Sorrentino that has that point of view, but it's in his book.
It is in his book. Yeah, so like the Red Swan, like also the Red Swan is a reference to is from At Some Two Birds. That is a hotel in At Some Two Birds. So again, At Some Two Birds is like the urtext for this. Like everything's like back to that. Trellis is part of it. Dermot Trellis is part of it. Red Swan's part of it. Anthony Lamont's part of it. Like all these names and all these like references are part of this other book in which the characters do take over and overthrow Dermot Trellis to be able to like escape his own writing because his writing is so bad. So they start in, to give away spoiler for At Some Two Birds, like the characters start writing their own version when he sleeps, in which they like torture him and like drop him out of windows and do all sorts of shit to him while he's sleeping as their way of getting revenge. So very, very fun. And that's what I think the Halperin and Beaumont here would like to do if they could. It's just like dump on Lamont. But yeah, what did you think of the Red Swan?
I think it helps expose his jealousy. It exacerbates his insecurities that he's trying to hide.
Mm-hmm.
I like that his title had red in it and all of his work is derivative.
Yeah.
It further shows that, you know, his nemesis book that's being appreciated for the genius that it is, and that's what he's trying to do, has red in the title. So, you know, that sparks him to change the title of it.
I mean, yeah, this description from, I love that. It's like where he says, it's from Vance Whitestone, and Lamont's reaction is solid, man. Ugh, Whitestone speak with forked tongue. I don't know that he should be appropriate at that moment, but anyways.
Like, is he trying to be like a cheap serial Indian from a Western or something in that? Whitestone. Yeah. Speak with full tongue, like
real cringy part of his,
which is all throughout this book with his work, you know.
Oh, like so much
the Jewish detective novel, or when he's trying to, you know, me no speak of the English, and you're like, what accent is this? What is this supposed to, who is this, what is who? Yeah, everything's so bad, so cringy, so awful.
But the description of what Red Swan is interesting in a way. So just what is the Red Swan? Primer of intangible loss, encyclopedia of regrets, Dictionary of Stupidities, Blazon of Decay, surely these, but it is also a depthless thesaurus of pleasures, a shopping list for the seeker of subtle and exquisite jests, an imaginative quantity of things actual, yet forever unknown, a roster of onieric possibilities. The style ranges from the frenzied and manic crackling of an unearthly static to the halting and imbecile stutter of a prophet of some barely glimpsed yet certain and jocose doom. The characters, or the varied persona, shift faces, costumes, and personalities as do clouds change their shapes. Yet withal, the root sadness that the narrative contains is rescued everywhere by what can only be termed a whim of grit, as our most ruffian critic of poetry has pronounced to be the tempering factor in what would otherwise be the unrelieved gloom and sleet of contemporary crushed simile verse, which is almost the book we're reading.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you could almost...
Such a jigsaw puzzle-like technique.
Got it circled.
Is also in that introduction, right?
There's so many jigsaw puzzles in this section. It's unreal. And blues. Always blue, always jigsaw.
Crushed simile verse. I underlined all the similes that were in that chapter. She is the queenly pearl.
Oh.
They are like unbelievably bad all throughout it. And they're all animal similes. Really? It was interesting going to change the book to Crocodile Tears.
Yeah.
And Red Swan being animal as well. But yeah. I mean, you get shit like this, crumpled in the fireplace like an old fish.
Oh, right.
A little bit later, my heart raged in my throat like a demented chicken. they're all over the place and they're all awful.
Yeah.
And you know, we still get all the that chapter begins with blue and ends with blacker than blue.
Yeah, so let's look at his. So we get one chapter of his book this time. It's She is the Queenly Pearl, in which essentially, like, I mean, it's insane. Lamont's talking to Daisy. She's telling him about all of her fuck history, and he's crying profusely at various moments in time. Then they bone twice, and she gets pregnant twice and has an abortion, but it's all like surreal and strange. But it also like is very like a nod to the is it Gertie McDowell section of Ulysses, where there's the older guy that sees the young girl on the beach, and a Roman candle goes off, fireworks go off, and as like he comes, and she's like masturbating. So it's like, it's very much like kind of like the back and forth of that section, but obviously not as good. And it's it's Gertie McDowell. It is goofy and like weird, and he gets really troubled by it. This is one of the things where like, where you're referencing of like he's being assaulted on all sides. After he writes this section, he's like, what am I gonna do? This isn't what I wanted. I'm out of control. I don't have anything anymore to do this. I feel like my characters are getting away from me. If I'm going to include this chapter, I have to go back and revise everything because Halpin's a different character here than he was before. And as I'm reading that, I'm also like, the fuck are you talking about, bro? Like, your character is not stable at all. Like, there's nothing like you, like, remarkably fixed about Halpern in any moment before here.
Also with Halpern, though, right after that, I feel like our gifted creator must be turning this thing into a comic novel or else he's losing his mind. And Ned was right. He hasn't had me call the police. I begin to feel sorry for him. So we know it's not a comic novel, and so it's the alternative, right? He's losing his mind.
Yeah. Although it is good, like, it's interesting how the book sets up, how Mulligan Stew sets up ways in which you can then, like, through the commentary from the other characters or others, you can read your, it sort of given, like, the clue as to how to read the section that came before or the section that's coming.
Yeah, like, it's a really good setup payoff that keeps happening over and over again. And I pointed out, I should find it before I talk about it. There's this section where they find that piece, A Garland of Impressions and Beliefs Culled from a Lifetime by E.B., a disappointed author. And in this weird list of things, like, there's these throwaway references. And then about five or six lines later, it comes back and like nails the joke off of the reference from before. And you keep seeing these repeating patterns. And it's the same thing he's doing in the larger scale with the chapters or with the letters. This just done on a smaller scale, which I thought was really cool.
It's really well crafted, which is very, very interesting. God, all the things I have circled here. My dear, she crooned, her loins surrendering. I'm pregnant again. It's so fucking bad.
Well, I wrote here too, like in the margin, worst transition ever. It goes from like talking about, her being pregnant, and then just out of nowhere, later, leaving the abortionist's office.
We embrace. I was just about to say, like, that is the most touchingly romantic thing one could include in this book.
That's your transitional sentence to get us to where we're like, what?
Wait, what time is it? Like, it's so wild.
It's like moments later, after my father died of a heart attack in the emergency room, we went to lunch. Like, wait a second.
I'm trying to find, like, he has, because it's interesting to tie that then to his, like, oh, no, but it must be before there. His letter to Joanne, which he's like written this thing that's like kind of a love story of sorts. Does it come before? No, it comes after. A few pages after he writes this chapter that he's like, I got out of control of, and it's supposed to be, I assume that it's supposed to indicate that Halperin was also involved with Daisy and loved her, and that's why he kills Ned Beaumont for wronging her. Like, maybe that's, like, I'm really grasping here, but like a sort of structure to his novel is to like giving Halperin a motivation of sorts. And so then after he writes this like quote unquote romance thing that harkens back to like Ulysses, he has a letter to Joanne. He's like, again, I'm sending this to our friend Helen. And I just want to hear from you. I just want something from you. You know, a discreet word, perhaps a snapshot for me to place on my desk from which to draw strength in the dark days of the soul approaching. Is that too much to ask? Yes, I hear you shout. Leave me alone. But I love you. I love you. I am stupid. It's like the ultimate like undercutting of everything that's like attempted romance becomes him like groveling for a pair of underwear and like a picture, and then realizing that he's like totally creeping her out.
Yeah, and it's that whole thing of like you get art imitating life and back and forth, that communication's happening back and forth in this. With the flambeau scene and letter that we get later.
Yeah, let's talk about the flambeau one and then I can go back to some other. So yeah, so he writes to Lorna Flambeau, sent the sweat of love, and he read it, and they were gonna have, he wanted her to come over for dinner so that she could read some of the poems aloud and she should dress casually and he'd read some of his stuff and blah blah blah. And that happens within the context of the book and does not go the way that he wants, obviously.
Is this kind of like a thesis statement in a way of confusing, you know, the author with the art, confusing the speaker of the poem with the poet, where he goes, first of all, I think that you must admit that your actions and words last night did not, quote, square with the sensual and exciting woman whose voice is heard in the sweat of love.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So since she wrote this erotic poem, she must clearly just be like,
it's clearly this horny, erotic person, yeah, this sexual creature waiting to be devoured. Like,
yep.
Obviously that's the leap you have to make based off of the work that's on the page.
And in the same way, then, like, as you would apply it nowadays, like, just because a character is questionable doesn't necessarily mean that the author is questionable. There's a separation. Sometimes there maybe isn't, but a lot of times there is. And yeah. And so like he does, so he has her over and then like basically tries to rape her over and over again. And even has her, this was going to be one of my lines. I have a lot of possible lines of the week. But, like, again, the erotic drawings and photographs that I asked you to look at are not by any means fuck pictures, as you undelicately put it. And then he talks about like wanting to, like, we could have had a deluxe limited edition of The Sweat of Love with a group of the pictures you shunned, a group selected, of course, by you. He's like trying to make her like poetry into like porn book.
I don't know if you know this, young lady, but you know, a Bloody Mary is an alcoholic drink.
You wanted tomato juice. Could have asked for it. Oh dear. There's also like one thing we didn't mention with like Sheila and Dermot, like essentially possibly torturing him from afar and disrupting his career, is that he receives from, I think it's from them, I assume, is an anonymous sketch. And the anonymous sketch seems to point to his career, but sort of fictionalized, or his life sort of fictionalized, and really just like belittling him. Like an anonymous sketch of like a person, a man, maker of maddening lists, a lister of maddening names, a namer of glistering fakes, an acre of pains, a wicker of aches, a flatulent bore, a sucker for horrors, an arthritic lout, a doubter of mythical lore, a chap who once knew semaphore. Gastritis is a sorry lot. It's hairy and furry and hot in the belly. Devourer of jelly and jam. The fingers oft crippled with pain of the pen. A yen for good legs and black hose. A shaker of fists. A lover of barter. Art is his god. A garter adorer. A clod. Which some of that does really map onto Lamont's like self, if you take yourself through his like obsessions within the writing, especially like the garter belt stuff. That was funny. This is a side note, but there was a letter from John to Sorrentino in which Sorrentino is working on Mulligan Stew, and John's letter is like, oh, I'm sorry, I've left a bunch of questions that you asked like unresolved from our previous letters. And then he like dates them and he's like, no, my wife does not really appreciate garter belts. And then it's like, they date the letter and it's like, I'm not sure if they have a good collection of like lingerie at this shop in this place. It's like all these funny references that clearly fit into like what he must be sharing from this book, or what he's talking about in relationship to this book, of that sort of lingerie obsession, which feels very 1970s, 100%. Then I don't know if you have anything else with those parts. There's so many jigsaw puzzles. I've got it circled on almost every page, it seems like.
That's kind of like that setup payoff. Aren't those in some ways like jigsaw puzzles, you know? Like from that, A Garland of Impressions, there's like the little things like, what if Proust had remembered the taste of Yankee Doodle? A little bit loaders, further down. Back home again in Indiana is a phrase that proclaims feelings of disgust. And then a little bit later, it's, you know, it may be well true that Sigmund Freud had a torrid love affair with Susan B. Anthony on one of his many trips to Indianapolis. So now we have love affairs taking place in Indianapolis. And then just a couple lines later, after mentioning Sigmund Freud, sex fantasies means that a person has a lot of sex or not enough or none at all. Like, so like, it's like these little, like I reference this, here's this. Yeah. In that I reference this, here's that. And like, you keep getting this like twisting and this turning, where everything sets up and pays off what came before in layer upon layer upon layer. It's really braided wonderfully and really, really clever.
And I think like the jigsaw puzzle thing too, beating that horse to death is always like a fun bit and a fun joke in my opinion. And I'm willing to go out on a limb and say that I'll bet a lot of like reviews of avant-garde books are like, this is like a jigsaw puzzle. This is like whatever, you have to put this together. Like even like I'm reading for my class, The Box, this by Mandy Suzanne Wong. And it's like each little section sort of, you can sort of like start to piece together like general themes or whatnot. And it's like, I could imagine, I'll bet like someone somewhere has reviewed and been like, The Box is like a mystery box, a jigsaw puzzle for readers astute enough to notice all the motifs sort of idea. So I think it might even be like a joke to that, but I love, this is the one that is cracked me up, where he's talking about deuces, where Sheila says that his three deuces is amusing. He's like, deuces may or may not be anything else, but it's certainly not what anyone would call amusing. Even my bitter enemy, John Carrot, was like, cute enough to call it a blur of geography. It's clearly much worse. Oh my God. And then there's like right in here too, in that letter where he's ranting about the Red Swan, it's just bad as crap. What do you call it? Like a cash, whatever. And then he puts, the idea of a novel about a writer writing a novel is truly old hat. Nothing further could be done with the genre, a genre that was exhausted at its moment of conception, which indicates that the Red Swan is that sort of book, which At Swim Two Birds is that sort of book, which Mulligan Stew is that sort of book. Like, there, and probably 85% of Delkey's library is that sort of book, is the idea of like, how do you create, how do you write, like all these like what questions come up within that. how they're treated. Like it's all there. But is there anything else with this? Because I have like the aphorisms and the cowboy stuff.
No,
my favorite part of this section.
Yeah, no, let's roll with it.
Let's go right in. Is that so in the house that Halperin and Beaumont are characters in, they find another room, and in this room, in the waste paper basket, there's like a bunch of these aphorisms that are written by like a manuscript that's written by someone, which ties back into an article that Lamont reads and includes in his notebook, in which Lamont's like, this news story or newspaper article in which this guy like falls asleep and wakes up, and there's like a fully formed book that he wrote that's there, and he doesn't remember any of it, and he's like, it's perfect, it's great, I'm sending it to my agent. And Lamont's like, fucker, man, I wish I could just have that happen to me. And then inside of his book, the characters find this new room, and as they're trying to escape, and they find a manuscript, a journal that's in the waste paper basket, that's a garland of impressions and beliefs culled from a lifetime by E.B., a disappointed author. And then what follows are like total batshit sort of aphorisms that are like pretty close to like when I'm screwing up cliches. This is similar to it, but like there's like, where there is smoke, there's always broken eggs. And then some of them, like Elaine Robegray's novels, can be read as reworkings of Charlie Chan plots. People who like Ring Lardner think they like baseball. Pitchers are bad hitters because they think of the ball as their friend. It is still one of the best lines.
I underlined that one because I figured it's a baseball reference. He's going to love it.
Got to have the baseball. And it is. I believe that. I think I sent that to you when I was first proofing this book again, because as someone who's an adamant like non-liker of pitchers, mayonnaise and mustard added are not too bad in a pinch. Well, by Norman Mailer's story, Naked Fires on the Moon is not about the United States Army as I knew it. But they're like, they're so fun and weird and wrong, like just like off. Often we are embarrassed by the words of little children who speak so innocently that we don't know what they're talking about.
Yeah, but again, even in this madness, there's like we were saying, those pieces that fit together and the setup and payoff, because there's a lot of like Yankee Doodle shows up a few times in it. Yeah. And then there's, you know, lines in the middle of that that say people who care about what visitors think of their city are not New Yorkers. And so you're kind of getting, there's this, yeah, like Europe and United States going back and forth. Just before that thing, I read about Sigmund Freud and Susan B. Anthony. At the top of that page, it says it is probable that Carl Jung came to this theory of the collective unconscious. Like, so like even just like mentioning things that influence others are back and forth in this as well.
And here's one that ties into what you said earlier. Back home again in Indiana is a phrase that proclaims feelings of disgust.
Yep.
Man, we're usually like fuck Ohio, but this time we're like fuck Indiana too. Oh, yeah.
You get a lot of Indiana and a lot of like eating American food.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Boland's last meal was probably Yankee pot roast with gravy.
There's also like the reference in the new book on 290. Keats and Shelley never had any of the conversations that the slanderous Miles O'Nolan attributes to them. That is a reference to, so Flann O'Brien's real name was Brian O'Nolan, and his pseudonym for his newspaper articles was Miles Nagopoline. And that included these fake conversations with Keats, and I believe Shelley as well, that were like always very funny and goofy. And then you get like the real punch. When Irish eyes are smiling, the whole world laughs at them. Taken deep. I still think this might be the greatest Irish book ever written. By Italian American. So we get those. And then when they go, when they find like, they do also find a bunch of like what's essentially like a publisher's catalog, their upcoming list of books, and they're not sure what it's from. Maybe it's from Lamont and from Halperin and Beaumont's company, but there's some like really wild ass, like strange books that are listed here, like The Pig Leap. in which the author, who spent 3 years disguised as a stupid homosexual policeman in order to gather his unsettling data, is the man who, like, they're like these poorly written, very weirdly semi-offensive descriptions. And my favorite has to be The Daddy and the Drake by Louis Condé, which includes, suddenly, into their lives comes Hoagie, a talking duck from Canada. There's also The Wrong Food Diet by Eustace Grayson that's like anti-Grayson. Mrs. Grayson demonstrates that foods such as fowl, red meat, fish, eggs, milk, green and yellow vegetables, honey, rice, whole grains, and beans and potatoes are not only unnecessary for good health, but are actually detrimental to it. Focusing on basic essentials, she shows how a diet built of the indispensables, newsprint, ash, and algae, can change the body's secret rhythms and bring us glowing health and boundless energy. Coming out in November, $7.50. It's so fucking funny. Oh, there's so, and then like there's like, yeah, the guy that, oh god, the guy that in the home in the I assume it's like in the Midwest is like making, like, has a recipe for a meat company. He's driven almost to the edge of insanity by the catcalls of the local spam consuming right wingers and insulted by the militant faction of the Rochester Brigade, who see his sausages as a threat to their native cuisine. Which, that would be funny if that was like a, that's like a Rochester, New York reference, like anti garbage plate. Like, we don't need your special meat. We've got garbage plates here. But they're on their walk and they run into the three who he's met before, Deuces Noonan, Sundog O'Haggerty, and Black Danny McGlade, who are from Chalice's novel, his experimental Irish cowboy novel. And they're they complain about it as being deplorable. And they're supposed to be Irish cowboys. So again, Charles is not talented either. Like the foil to Lamont is not even better than he is, which is fun too. Like, rather than it being like, oh, you know, here's like a really good famous author and you're trash compared to it, it's like, here's another trash author who's like doing better than you. Why aren't you capable of it? And she has their tired and true watery blue eyes. They start talking about the things that they've had to do in novels and in stories. And they're just like, every goddamn cliche you can think of is in here. And they're just sort of riffing on it. Like, what about the fellow who wimps no matter what he said? Or the one who sighed all the time? And it's like, yeah, I've heard this in books before. Like, all the, like, there's always blue smoke, especially when there's blue smoke. All the women, did she dab her eyes? Of course, with my handkerchief. Were her hands cold? Yes, they trembled. Sure, surely her lips trembled as well. That is when she wasn't reflectively pursing them. It's like all the descriptions that you can hear and see in like schlock hack novels are all just like right here, like written out, where they're like, God, do I have to do this again? Like, I so often have to go to bed, I have to take off my pants without putting on anything. Like all these like weird conundrums of like bad fiction. I love this part. I think this part is hilarious because it's like, it's like the real cliches to try and avoid. But here he repurposes them to great comedic effect.
Yep.
Was there a kind of emptiness in her gaze? Exactly, a lackluster eye. What's more depressing is walking down the red clay roads of the South. Oh, the South, the pickup trucks, the courthouse squares, the little towns that time forgot. You must admit that time forgets a lot of things. It also hangs heavy, or seems to stop. The latter often happens at the same time the heart misses a beat. You speak, of course, of relentless time.
I'm wearied of jumping out of bed and putting on my shoes, but no socks.
Oh, I love it. Which the judge, they're talking about like one of the books, and the judge took to rocking on the veranda all day. Did he rock determinedly? He did, sometimes hypnotically. Did his staring eyes look at nothing? They did. A fixed stare it was. And a blank one. Yet perhaps he was seeing the wreckage of his life. All these scenes are painted so beautifully.
They're almost like just like movie extras, like sitting outside the studio wall, like outside the studio walls, you know.
Yeah.
And they're smoking cigarettes, you know, and you can hear. In one job, I threw my clothes on at least 20 times. Oh, you think that's bad? Well. Exactly. Just talking about this is the crap we have to do. Oh god,
got to throw on my clothes. Oh my god, it's really fun. It's very fun. I don't know if there's anything else with this. Although So there is there's this part where who's saying this though? Ned's saying this, where he's talking about like, well, authors distrust characters who run out on novels in progress. They respect them if the novels are garbage. The character who stays to the bitter end in a rotten book dooms himself to a career of working in the same book kind of book over and over again. He went on and on telling me of a Mr. Shandy and an Emma Bovary, people who had never worked again after their initial jobs. They were legendary and everyone respected them. By the same token, the poor clucks who first went to work for hack writers worked for them all the time and became, in fact, incapable of working for anyone else. I think that's interesting too, because those are like, there's so many characters that are recycled either through name, like they're recycling it name wise here and not necessarily like character wise, but also like characters are fairly recyclable and recyclable. But like Emma Bovary and Tristram Shandy are like pretty unique.
Yeah.
Unreplicable. Do you have anything else with this section you want to?
No, I think I've got my, we've done a lot of great lines, but I think I got mine. Ready to fire.
Go for it.
So yeah, our author that's losing his mind, that we slightly start feeling some sympathy for, let's like lose all of that with his PS in his letter to Flambeau. So he writes that long letter about how he wasn't trying to get her drunk and take advantage of her. PS, I must add that your cardinal sin in my eyes was in your mistaking my interest in you as a poet with a sexual interest. My dear lady, sex is easy to come by. Art is not. Your error-bred arrogance and contempt for a man who was prepared to advance your career. I am not exactly unknown in literary and publishing circles. Perhaps this experience will teach you wisdom.
I love that. I do want to say one other thing. There are a lot of embedded Joyce references to here, like Shem from is referenced in Finnegan's Wake. The thunderclap is in Finnegan's Wake. There's a lot of that. And then there's a bunch of references, Imagine of Colleys of Actual Things, which has like a bit where like a poet goes to throw out the trash, but throws himself out instead and comes back like as a kind of empty person. Like there's that, and Sheila Henry is part of that book. And all those references are embedded in here too, which from the very beginning, in a lot of the rejection letters, they're all like, oh, I loved your qualities of actual imagination things. They're like, they always get the title wrong and everyone's like all screwy with it. It's very funny. But to tie in with your line of the week, I'll do the other PS. PS, you of course understand that I have nothing against Dermot personally.
after four letters of just crap, like four pages of crapping on his face.
Yeah. Just like shitting down his throat. Really? Like, yeah. Yeah, no, it's not personal. He's a great guy. Totally so right.
Yeah, I take it back. I don't feel sorry for him at all anymore.
So for next week, we go up to page 395 in the new edition and up to 336 in the old one. Again, have not looked ahead. Oh, this one's going to drive you insane. This section has the equivalent of the third chapter of Ulysses, which is like very tough for people to get through because it's like these murky philosophical moving sand sort of thing where you have no real footing. Whereas in here, the sort of like variation on that is a really long math article.
All right.
Like high level math. I proofed this whole thing. I sort of got, there's no way I can read this again. Like it's like so far beyond anything that I understand. And like, just like, I don't even know if it's like, funny or what, it's just like so many fucking footnotes and so many, I mean, it's pretty funny though, I guess. So I don't know. We'll see. But that's in there. That'll be entertaining. And includes every type of writing. And that sort of writing is one of them.
Okay. Oh, that's a stunning endorsement. Oh, good luck. This is going to be painful. Have fun.
Oh, it's not super long, but I think like proofing it was like, oh man, footnotes, all the footnotes are screwed up and had to be written, and checking every one of those like math equations. Not super fun, but it's an interesting part too. I mean, it is pretty fun. And being able to read it now, I think maybe I'll like it more rather than having to read it where it's like line by line, checking every little thing. Sure. This is a little bit more enjoyable, but anyways, I have nothing else to say. Go D-backs, and that's it. Yeah, I love them. D-backs, got flow. Totally a blow.
Little south side.